Presentation is vestibular evoked myogenic potentials, and as the name suggests, that it is something which is evoked from the vestibular system, and it's a myogenic potential. And basically, we record from two of the muscles. One is the neck muscle, that is the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and second is the inferior oblique muscle, from where we are getting this. And these are very short latency potentials which we are recording, and by presenting a loud sound. So when I was presenting the other presentation, I said that the diameter is only 0.8 mm, and so it doesn't allow the sound to create any kind of sensation to us. And hence, here to record the VEMP, what we are doing is we are increasing the intensity of the sound so that the vestibular system respond to the sound, and then we are recording this. Now, there are basically two types of vestibular evoked myogenic potential. One is cervical vestibular evoked myogenic potential, and second is the ocular vestibular evoked myogenic potential. What we have to remember here is the cervical vestibular evoked myogenic potential is assessing the saccule and the inferior vestibular nerve, whereas the ocular VEMP is assessing the utricle and the superior vestibular nerve. So, saccule, inferior vestibular nerve, utricle and the superior vestibular nerve. And we have to remember this pathway. This is the pathway for the cervical VEMP, and this is the pathway for the ocular VEMP. In the cervical VEMP, when we stimulate the saccule, the action potential is generated in the inferior vestibular nerve. It goes to the vestibular nuclei. Through the mediovestibular spinal tract, it comes to the spinal accessory nucleus. And from here, a short connection which goes to the ipsilateral sternocleidomastoid muscle. And where in the ocular VEMP, what happens is when we are stimulating the utricle, it goes to the vestibular nuclei, but it takes a contralateral route, and through the medial longitudinal fasciculus, it is supplied to the inferior oblique muscle. So here it is ipsilateral, and this is the contralateral response which is there. So here saccule, inferior vestibular nerve, and here it is utricle and the superior vestibular nerve where we are targeting this. And this is the typical electrode setting which we are doing for the CVMP and the OVMP. In the CVMP, the positive electrode is placed on the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and the negative electrode is placed on the sternoclavicular joint, and the ground electrode is here, and the stimulus is on the side of the electrode, whereas in the ocular VEMP, the positive electrode is placed 1 centimeter below the eye, and the negative electrode is placed 1 centimeter below this, and this is the ground electrode which will be placed. But stimulus is not on the same side, the stimulus is there on the contralateral side, because the pathway for the OVMP is contralateral in nature. And these are the parameters which we use for recording the cervical VEMP. So this is tone burst and a 500 Hz stimulus, and we give a very high intensity sound, that is 95 dB NHL, on which we are recording. So this is the typical recording system for the cervical VEMP, and this is the recording system for the ocular VEMP. There is no difference in the recording protocol of the two, except for the filter setting here and the electrode montage over here. That's it. There are only two things which are different in cervical and the ocular VEMP. One is the electrode montage, and second is the filter settings. This is the waveform which we get. This is the typical waveform of cervical vestibular evoked myogenic potential when we are recording from the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and this when we are recording from the inferior oblique muscle. So here, first peak is a positive peak, and the second peak is a negative peak. This comes around 13 milliseconds, this comes around 23 milliseconds, wherein this peak is, there are three peaks. First is a negative peak, which comes around 10 milliseconds. After that, the second peak is positive, which comes around 14 milliseconds. And this is the third peak, again negative, which comes around 20 milliseconds. So these are the timing in which these three peaks are occurring in ocular VEMP. Now, we'll go the disease-wise, that what we are getting. So vestibular neuritis, as we have known, that basically it is a vestibular loss due to the infection in the superior vestibular nerve. And most of the time, we think that the vestibular neuritis is caused in the superior vestibular nerve. But there are incidences where what happens is, when we have superior vestibular nerve, we can do the caloric and we get to know that, yes, there is a problem in the superior vestibular nerve. But there are cases where there is an involvement of the inferior vestibular nerve also in the vestibular neuritis. In that case, what happens, that we do not have any test which can detect the inferior vestibular nerve neuritis. In these cases, the cervical VEMP assesses this vestibular neuritis. So the vestibular neuritis can be three types. First is the superior vestibular nerve neuritis, which can be almost like 90% of the cases, and remaining 10% of the cases, either they are inferior vestibular nerve neuritis or they are mixed neuritis. That is, it is the infection of both the nerves. So if we are assessing through the ocular vamp, we will be able to get to know the superior vestibular nerve neuritis. And if we are using a combination of the CVAMP and the OVAMP, then we will be able to know the superior vestibular nerve neuritis and also the inferior vestibular nerve neuritis. Coming to the cases of the idiopathic sudden sensory neural hearing loss, and as we know that most of the cases with idiopathic sudden sensory neural hearing loss, the cause is thought to be there in a moving emboli in this artery which is there. And there are studies which says that not only the cochlea but also the vestibular system which is involved in cases with idiopathic sudden sensory neural hearing loss. And this is a study by Iwasaki et al. In 1995, where he has given the percentage of involvement of cochlea, cochlea plus saccule, and cochlea plus saccule plus canal. So these are the percentage of cases where there is not only the cochlear involvement but also there is vestibular involvement, which is also there in cases with idiopathic sudden sensory neural hearing loss. And this is our study wherein we took 10 cases with all sudden sensory neural hearing loss, and we found that in the affected ears, the CVAMP was absent in 9 cases, OVAMP was absent in 8 cases, whereas caloric was showing a hypofunction response in all the 10 cases. And the surprising factor was one more, wherein we are still, we don't know what was the reason. That is, in the normal cases also, in some cases, the CVAMP, OVAMP and the calorics were absent, wherein this ear had a very much normal hearing threshold, or this ear had no problem which was there. So this one. So what we have to understand is, another thing is that because it's the same cavity, so if the individual has a hearing loss which is occurring because of the cochlear problem, they might have a vestibular problem. And if we want to know that what can be the degree of hearing loss and what can be the degree of vestibular involvement, as we move from moderate degree of sensory neural hearing loss and higher, the chances of vestibular involvement becomes high in the cases with sensory neural hearing losses. These are the two studies from our laboratory once again. And here we found this particular group, they found that in children who had hearing loss, in them the CVAMP was affected. That means say that they had some problem with the saccular structure or probably the inferior vestibular nerve. And we also found that not only the CVAMP but also the OVAMP, which was affected in cases who had congenital hearing loss. The other cases where you can find a typical finding is auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder. And in auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder, what we have to know is there is a presence of otoacoustic emission which suggests that cochlea is normal, but ABR is affected, which suggests that the neural part of the auditory system which is affected. And what happened that most of the literature, when we go through the auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder, they describe about the problem which is there in the auditory system about the auditory deficits, because even though these cases might have a normal hearing, but the speech perception in these cases are very poor. And they do not, most of the literature, they do not describe about the vestibular problem in this. But what we have to understand is, again the same thing, because both are the part of the same nerve, that is the 8th nerve. So if there is any pathology which is affecting the cochlear branch of the 8th nerve, it can as well affect the vestibular branch. But most of the cases remain asymptomatic with respect to the vestibular sign and symptoms, because of it is a slow progressive disease, and also because it is bilateral in nature, the compensation occurs, and that's why they remain asymptomatic. And this was our first study where we tried to characterize this vestibular deficits in auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder. And here we took 10 individuals with auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder, and we found that out of 10, 9 individuals had problem in CVAMP recording. That means say that they all had. What we have to understand is, now in the cases with auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder, as I said that the cochlea is normal, so we are assuming that the vestibular system, the inner ear part is still normal, and because the nerve is affected here, the nerve is affected on the other side also. So in 9 cases, this was absent, suggesting that there was a problem with the inferior vestibular nerve. And these are our project which we took up in the cases with auditory neuropathy. And in these cases, we found that the CVMP is absent, OVMP is absent, even the caloric is totally hypofunction. It doesn't induce, even the Cobrax test doesn't induce any kind of vestibular symptoms in these cases, indicating that the cases with auditory neuropathy spectrum disorder are bilateral vestibulopathy cases. So they all have the problem in the vestibular system. Next case, that is benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. So this we have been hearing, and we have learned that it is because of the displacement of the autocornea. And what we have to remember is, here we are targeting nothing but, here we know that the autocorneas are dislodged from the utricle and then it is coming to the semicircular canal. When it is coming to the semicircular canal, there are two types of changes. Mostly we talk that there is one change which has happened, the autocornea has been dislodged and it has come to the canal, so the canal has become sensitive to the gravity. But we have to remember that there are two changes. One is that the utricle has become light because the mass has been dislodged from there, and the semicircular canal has become sensitive to gravity because the mass is lying there now. And if that doesn't get treated for a longer time, then what will happen is there will be secondary degenerations which will start in the utricular hair cells. So if the maneuver is done also at a later point of the time, what is going to happen is, already if there is a degenerated hair cells in the utricle, then what will happen is the post maneuver they will persist with some amount of dizziness. Okay, and here when we are talking about utricle, we found that the OVMP is useful because OVMP is assessing the utricle and its innervative structure, and hence what happened that OVMP is useful in cases with BPPV, not the CVM. And this was our study, and when we studied, we found that CVMP is not at all useful in cases with BPPV because it doesn't give me any kind of information, because CVMP is basically assessing the saccule and the inferior vestibular nerve, and BPPV we are talking about utricle, so CVMP is not at all useful. This is again from our vestibular lab, which study is there. This again a study from our vestibular lab only, and where we found that the OVMP is very much useful in cases with BPPV. That is, we are able to detect the problem or the pathology in the utricle of the individuals who have got benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. Coming to the Meniere's disease, so we all know that endolymphatic hydrops, it is, and it affects both the cochlear as well as vestibular system. Also that it's a simple rule that anything which is affecting the cochlea will definitely affect the vestibular structure, because it is the same cavity and the same fluid, so it is going to affect there. Now here it affects the utricle, saccule and the canal also, and overall incidence of abnormal VEMP in cases with Meniere's disease is roughly 58%. So if you record 58% of the cases, you will be able to detect either a saccular pathology or utricular pathology. Most of the cases will show absence or decreased VEMP. Latencies remains to be normal, but there is another paradigm which we are looking into, that is shift of frequency tuning of VEMP. That is nothing but, if we record VEMP, whether it is cervical VEMP or whether it is ocular VEMP, if I record in 1,000 normal patient, normal individuals who have normal vestibular system, it comes good with a 500 Hertz tone buster stimulus. 500 Hertz tone buster stimulus. That means say that there is a tuning that around 500 Hertz, the CVMP or the OVMP is good. But in cases with Meniere's disease, in some Meniere's disease, the CVMP or the OVMP is good at either 1000 Hertz or either 1.5 kilohertz. So what is happening is, because of the degenerations, there is a change in the stiffness characteristics of the saccule and the utricle, and because of which there is a change in the tuning. So we get a good VEMP at 1 or 1.5 kilohertz. Based on that, we made a protocol wherein we said that in the Meniere's disease, record CVMP or the OVMP at 500 Hertz. And now suppose if it is absent, we can terminate the test, saying that, okay, fine, there is a pathology, so we can terminate the test. But if it is present, then record at 1 kilohertz also and 1.5 kilohertz also, and compare the amplitude with 500 Hertz, whether it is, which one is more. If the amplitude is higher at 1 kilohertz or 1.5 kilohertz, terminate the test, and this indicates that there is a problem. in the saccule or the utricle because of the change in the resonance frequency of the saccule and the utricle. But if the amplitude remains higher at 500 hertz, then send the case for further referrals and see that whether the case really falls into the Meniere's disease or whether the case has some other problems also. Now, there have been an attempt to look for the WEMP and the glycerol test also. So, post-glycerol they have tried to do, and this is a study by Murafusi et al. In 2001, and where they have taken total 17 subjects, and in which they found positive WEMP in 5 subjects. That means say that post-glycerol there was an improvement in the WEMP response in 5 subjects, and all these 5 subjects were in a stage 2 Meniere's disease, and these cases were in stage 1 Meniere's disease. So probably this has to do with the stage, and the sensitivity of the glycerol and the WEMP is probably less over here compared to the usual glycerol tests. Things which we have to remember in when we are doing the WEMP, that is, first thing is get the uncomfortable loudness level of all the person. What we have to remember is we are looking into the inner ear pathologies, and if the individual has inner ear pathology, they all might have recruitment, and when they have recruitment, we cannot present the sound at a higher intensity. So we have to check the UCL that they don't have any uncomfortable level for the sound, and then we go ahead with the recording. Second is that rule out middle ear pathology, because even a mild middle ear pathology, when the airborne gap is roughly around 20 to 25 dB, it will lead to absence of WEMP. That is, whether it is CWEMP or OWEMP, it is going to be absent. So basically, first we have to rule out the middle ear pathology, and then we can go ahead. Assuring neck muscle activation is the biggest problem when we are recording cervical WEMP. So what we are doing is, in the cervical WEMP, we are turning the head, we saw the electrode, the person is moving the head to the opposite side. We have to contract the sternocleidomastoid muscle to get a good amplitude, and this becomes problem especially in children or the geriatric cases over there. Patient not cooperative for the testing is a problem, and sound not getting to the ears, this we have to ensure that when we have placed the insert, it is 95 dB. And the thing which I want to say is, use the WEMP for knowing the saccular or the utricular deficits. Depending upon sign and symptoms and case history, please diagnose the case. So for the diagnosis, whether it is Meniere's, labyrinthitis, neuritis or whatever it is, please use the case history, use the sign and symptoms, look for the sign and symptoms, do other tests. Here you can do the WEMP and you can know that whether they have a saccular deficits or whether they have a utricular deficits. Something like, for example, if there is a case with ototoxicity or there is a case with Meniere's disease, if I am not aware of the sign and symptoms of, say, that ototoxicity, or I am not aware of Meniere's disease, every pathology is, the ototoxicity or the Meniere's disease, if I'm not aware, I'm just keeping that I'm not aware about the pathology, I just do the WEMP blindly. Then what I'm going to do is, in the ototoxicity also I'm going to get absent WEMP, in the Meniere's disease also I'm going to get absent WEMP, in labyrinthitis also I'm going to get absent WEMP. So the disease is affecting the saccule, disease is affecting the utricle, it is leading to the absence of CWEMP or the OWEMP. So I cannot make a conclusion saying that this is absent, so this is labyrinthitis, this is absent, so this is neuritis, or this is absent, so this is this one. So this is only to know that whether they have a saccular deficits, utricular deficits, combine the case history, combine the sign and symptoms, then diagnose the case. Thank you for the patient listening.